Good evening and welcome all. Ada from Lucknow, city of Awadh. I thank the college SVIT Warsaw for inviting me and telling something about the heritage and culture of the city of Lucknow at this series of yours, which has been very interesting. I've been following the lectures and it's a very good initiative. Now, coming to Lucknow, a very famous historian said Lucknow was the Baghdad and Cordova of East and Bukhara and Nishapur of India. He's a very famous historian. And in fact, Bertrand Russell, the war correspondent of British India, he said, not Rome, not Constantinople seems to be so tempting as the Lucknow skyline. It was in the early 18th century. So that was it, the magnificence and the glory it was. And of course, now the new people are adding to it. It's not that. So now what are the elements which make the city's character? Is it only the buildings, its streets, its by-lanes, its art, culture, its lifestyle? No, it's everything together which makes the identity of a city. That's the reason it's been recognized as an epitome of art, culture, sophistication, etiquette and mannerism, not just architecture. Of course, we have magnificent buildings all around scattered in the city. But it's all together, amalgamation of various kinds of these elements, which makes it so grand and so magnificent. It was in the year 1721, with the arrival of a dynasty from Iran, Nishapur, Saadat Ali Khan Burhan Mulk, that brought new ideas, new fashion, new culture to the city, which was open at that particular time due to the decline of the Mughals in Delhi. And of course, these dynasty from Iran, they had that political freedom and a lot of wealth with them. So it was the right time. And after that, the interplay, the power play between the Britishers, because the Britishers had arrived in the early 1800, and it was the interplay and the jostling of their ideas upon Lucknow which created this magnificent architecture in the city and the amalgamation of the hybrid style of Hindu, Islamic and colonial architecture, which created this magnificence. So now, but Lucknow is a very old city. What was it before the Nawabs? It said that Lord Rama, he presented the city of, in fact, the province of this from the Awadh, this particular city, to his brother Lord Lakshman as a gift, as a present after he won the war of Lanka. So it was also called as Lakshmanvati or Lakhnauti at that particular time. And due to the presence of Adi Ganga Gomti in the city, it was also called Choti Kashi at that time. And it was a entrance gateway of the ancient province of Kaushal Rajya at the time of Buddha. It was the entrance gateway. Lakhnauti, it was at that time called. And an ancient rishi by the name of Kaundilya. We all have heard about his name. He had a very big ashram at the banks of the river, and a lot of pilgrims from all over the place used to visit the city for the pilgrimage and to see him. That's how it was a Hindu state at that particular time. Slowly, and in fact, the Kushan period and the Shunga period bricks have been also found here in the excavations. Later on, when the Mughals came, it said that in fact Akbar had also visited the city, and he got at his arrival, a gateway was constructed, and still it is at Shahganj by the name of Akbari Gate. It is still there. Of course, a lot of encroachments are there, but it is still present. It still exists. And at his time, his minister, Abdul Rahim, his tomb got constructed here because he stayed here for a while, and by the name of Nadan Mahal. It's there in the old city. And after that, not many sheikhs and Pathans had settled here, and slowly and gradually this Islamic culture came into being in the city of Lakshmanavati. So that is in crux the pre-Nawabi period. Now in 1731-32, this dynasty from Iran arrives, and in fact the Mughals, they appointed the Subedar of Awadh, Sadat Ali Khan Burhanmulk, and his capital was Faizabad in Awadh. It's near to Lucknow, almost 40 to 50 kilometers away. So, now can I start my slides, please? Can I share? Hey, one second.
The hub, yeah.
Could you hear me? I'm not sure. Was I visible?
Yeah. You are visible and audible also.
Okay. Thank you. So I'll start my slideshow. In fact, it got delayed. These are some magnificent buildings of Nawabi period, and that's the ancient pre-Nawabi picturization, the Gomti, and that's the Choti, it was called Choti Kashi, and the Adi Gomti is flowing, and that's how, this is the Tilewali Masjid, which got constructed in the Mughal period. The left hand side, the white masjid, that's the pre-Nawabi period. And now if you come to the genealogy of the Nawabs, now the first Nawab, Sadat Ali Khan Burhanmulk, he was appointed as the governor of Awadh, and he was stationed at Faizabad. Then, of course, there is one Mughal appointee. He is not very known in the history, but then Nawab Safdarjung, he was the son-in-law of Sadat Ali Khan. He played a very major role. And in fact, he's the very famous Safdarjung's tomb is there in Delhi. And that was the prototype of all Nawabi buildings afterwards. Then came Shuja-ud-Dawla, his son. In fact, he was the one who started quarreling and having battles with the Britishers. And from his time onwards, the Britishers became anti-Nawabs. He was the one, he fought the Battle of Buxar with Mir Qasim in Bengal. So he was an important Nawab of Awadh. Then came Asafuddaula. He is the person who brought the golden period of in Lucknow, and he shifted his capital from Faizabad to Lucknow. In fact, it said that to come out from the shadows of Shuja-ud-Dawla and his dominant mother, he shifted his capital from Faizabad to Lucknow, and it was his period when these Bhadai Mambara, the Bhul Bhulaiya, the Rumi Darwaza, all these grand buildings came into being. He is the main builder of the city of Lucknow. And for a small period, this Asif Jah Mirza came into the reign, but he was removed by the Britishers because he was again very anti-British. Then the next Nawab, the Sadat Ali Khan, he was the half-brother of Asafuddallah, and he also played a very important role in the history of Awadh, and he had also built quite a few buildings in Lucknow. For example, Dilkusha, then of course, residency was built in his time for the Britishers, for the Governor General of the British. He was he had that particular compound built for him, for them. And then Chhatar Manzil, Sarkhanda, lot many buildings were built in his time. So these two Nawabs are the most important Nawabs who had built Lucknow. Then came the first king of Awadh. In fact, he had cut his ties with the Mughal and he declared himself the king with the support of the British, Ghazi Uddin Haider. In 1814, he declared himself as the king of Awadh, and he was no longer the Subedar or the Nawab. He called himself Badshah. Then his son, Nasiruddin Haider, he was very pro-British, and he was in fact inclined, and he copied British. And at his time, that amalgamation of European elements came into the hybrid style of Awadh. He had built few buildings, but he was very much inclined towards the British. Then Muhammad Ali Shah, he came. He was another one of the good kings of Awadh, and he had built Chota Imambara, the Husainabad tank, the Sarkhanda, and quite a few good buildings in his time were built. Then Amjad Ali Shah, he was a very pious Nawab, and he was also called as the Hazrat. And in his time, the main street was came to into being as Hazrat Ganj. And his son, Bajid Ali Shah, now he is the most popular and known name in history of Awadh, who was at whose time Awadh was annexed by British, and he was sent to exile. And he had built some beautiful buildings which were razed by the British. So he is the last Nawab of, in fact, Awadh, the living Nawab. And after that, of course, Begum Hazrat Mahal, she fought the first war of independence. The very famous, the siege of residency happened because of her. She was the Begum of Wajid Ali Shah. And when Wajid Ali Shah went to Calcutta and Meteor Burj, she took the reins in her hand and she fought the British. And she was a brave lady. And in fact, she was more of a man than her husband. And her son, Birgis Kadr, both of them were, in fact, they had to elope to Nepal to escape the British. And that was the tragic end of this dynasty of Nawabs of Lucknow. Now, of course, Lucknow architecture, if we talk it, we cannot escape Nawabi architecture. That's the main component of our history. And this Nawabi architecture can be divided into two parts. The first part, of course, the Asafuddallah and Sadat Ali Khan from 1775 to 1800. And here the architecture was mainly post-Mughal, and the Mughal elements were used, traditional phase it was. And but at the same time, there was a French builder by the name of Claude Martin, who was introduced by Antoine Poilier in the court of Shuja-ud-Dawla, who was making lot many buildings, was building lot many things in Lucknow, and he had amassed wealth through fighting with the British, in fact. And he was, in fact, a courtier in the court of Asafuddallah, and Asafuddallah was very much impressed and very much sort of influenced by his buildings. And in fact, all the Nawabi buildings then afterwards were influenced, and a lot of impact can be seen of European elements after Claude Martin's building. Now, after 1800, with the arrival of the British, it was a period when the amalgamation happened, and it was the period of Wajid Ali Shah, the last Nawab of Awadh. And he was, in fact, an art-loving and culture-loving Nawab who had a penchant for building not many buildings, but he had a very soft taste and sophisticated taste. And in his time, this Kesar Bagh Palace came into being, which is no more, only the gateways are here. It was influenced by postmodern architecture of Europe. And in fact, it was neoclassical in style. Not many European elements were added. The Moorish turrets and the statuary of European architecture, the chhatris of Hindu architecture, the gilded domes, not many amalgamation, but it was a magnificent palace office which was raised by British after the First War of Independence, as it was said that it was here that the whole conspiracy was hatched by Begum Hazrat Mehr, and they wanted it to be no more, so that more patrolling can be done and more policing can be done against Indians, so that no more rebellion can take place. Now, if in detail, if we come to phase one, when Nazifuddallah shifted his capital to Lucknow, it was a wooded bank of River Gomti, nothing much, some hillocks, and prominently there were Brahmins and some Shia community. There he consolidated the existing fort of Pathans that was called Machhi Bhavan, and the main features of this architecture was the stucco work which came into being. It was a revival of a Deccani architecture, the relief work on plastered wall, and the plaster wall was basically lime water mixed with seashells, the powder of seashells and mother of pearl, which could give you a shine of more than a marble sheen. So that's the reason with this plaster, the Lucknow buildings shine like marble. And because we don't have rocks, we don't have stone over here. The material used is all brick kiln bricks, and they were called Lakhori bricks, 2 centimeters by 15 centimeters by 10 centimeters. So they were thin slacks of bricks which were very helpful in mimicking stone. And they built the wall and they plastered it with that white lime mortar. They gave sheen, and on that the stucco work was done, which was sort of relief work, and the carving was done. Floral patterns, the geometric patterns, the calligraphy. The calligraphy is a decorative way of writing. In fact, the ayats of Quran, they were sort of carved out of that stucco work. So it was this particular feature which was very became prominent, that we can see in this, that white building. It's part of Chota Imam Bada. And this is Rumi Darwaza. And of course, this is the building of Claude Martin, the European, the French builder who had built in the amalgamated style of, that style is called Indo-Sassanic style, with the elements of Hindu, the French, and the Islamic. All features have been used in this. So, and in fact, this is the Bada Imam Bada. And this is a part of, in fact, that Aspi Mosque. And this is the gateway, and it is the pictures taken standing on the Bada Imam Bada. So this is the second phase, which the Wajid Ali Shah was the main builder, and he built Kesar Bagh. This is a, in fact, this is a picture of this Kesar Bagh. It was on a theme of Asian theme with a walled enclosure and independent buildings inside. And of course, the pavilions, the fountains, and the landscaping of Charbagh, lot of statues from European style, Ionic column, Tuscan columns, minarets. That was a style which he had used and will be coming in detail afterwards. And the other building which was at that time played a very important role was the residency. The residency was in fact built by Saadat Ali Khan for the British Governor General to basically for the Britishers to stay together. And it had a compound which had lot many buildings in European style villa, which with the long porticos and Ionic pillars, circular pillars, and of course verandas all over its sides for the reason of tropical summers. So and in fact after the rebel of in fact the first war of independence, the mutiny, which Britishers used to call, we call it first war of independence, Sir Patrick Geddes, the very famous urban planner, was invited by the Britishers to replan the city so that the new road network can be brought in and patrolling and more policing can be done in the city so that no conspiracies can be hatched further. Now, one thing which is very important to Lucknow architecture is you can see that there are lot of imamvadas in the city. Now, what are imamvadas? Actually, these were originally are called Husainias or Majlisi in Iran and Iraq. And in India, in the south, it is called Ashur Khana. And in fact, Astana is, they are also called or there. And in fact, they are useful in the month of Muharram, the first 10 days of Muharram, and where the Matam is being, performed in the sense they had so many ways to show their grief towards the killing of Hussein and Hassan, who were killed at Makkah. So this is the expression of their sorrow through Soz Khwani and poetry form, which developed in Lucknow, and Lucknow became very famous the world over. And people come here to listen to this Soz Khwani, the expression of grief towards Hussein and Hassan. So this is the front facade of Bada Imamvada, the famous Bulbulaiya. And these are the forms of matam. They walk on the burning coal, then they beat their chest. There's so many ways. And the poetry is beautiful. Mir Anis is a very famous poet of here who had written a lot of poetry on Soz. So for these reasons, these imamvadas were built. And in fact, they had three parts. First part is the entrance, then the majlisi. Majlisi is a space where congregation used to happen. All these people used to gather. And the third part was called Shahnishin. The Shahnishin was a raised platform, 2-3 steps above, and where all these taziyas were put. Taziyas are replicas of the tomb of Hussein in Makkah. So that they all paper in gold, they make the replicas, the models of that tomb and put it there, and then they do the Soz Khwani, the central bay, that is the majlisi. And the side bays are used for accessory functions, for eating and for meals and etc. etc. And upstairs they have galleries for women in parda. The women can see the proceedings from the mezzanine floor above, down what's happening in whatever is happening down below. So this was basically, and they were inspired from rozas of Iran and Iraq, which were basically square in plan, and the tomb was supposed to be in the center in a large courtyard, and a dome was up above from where the light was brought in, and there was a pathway to circumambulate around it. So it was, in fact, this particular one bay was elongated in imamvadas, And they took the form of this particular type of building, which in afterwards known came to known as Imamgarhas. Now this is a very particular feature of Lucknow architecture. In fact, Lucknow is famous for this. In fact, can you believe this is a parapet of a Imamgarha, which has domes, which has arches, multifoliated arches and domes above. And at the corners, we have chhatris. And that became a typical feature of the architecture, which in fact repeated afterwards when Imamgarha was built. Afterwards, lot many buildings had this exclusive parapet, beautiful parapet with arches and domes, lot many arches. And at the corners, they were accentuated. They were edged by the chhatri, the chhajja, and lot many cornices and stucco work. That's a typical feature of the architecture, we can say that. And this is the hall, the biggest hall. In fact, this is the entrance veranda. This is the biggest hall of the Bada Imamgarha, which was a magnificent engineering feat at the time of Asafuddallah, the Bada Imamgarha, for which Lucknow is famous for. Now, coming to the complex, how do they place their building? Now, there are two sects in Muslims. We all know the Sunnis and the Shias. The Sunnis, they don't pay very big attention to Imamgarha. They are more concerned with Masjid, now the mosque. But the Shias, they place the Imamgarhas in the center, always in the center, and Masjid at the side, the aligning to the Makkah. But the Imamgarha is always in the center. So this is the difference between the buildings of these two sects. The mosques are subsidiary in the Shia buildings, and the Sunni buildings, these are in the centrally placed, which we can see in a lot of the Mughals. They have always the mosque in the center, but Nawabs of Lucknow, they had at the side. So that's how we can, in fact, explain and understand. Now, these arches and columns have also a very special feature. You can see now this is the stucco work, which I was trying to explain. And this is the minute carving in that lime mortar, which Lucknow is famous for. And this is the typical parapet with not many arches and domes and the chhatri at the end. So, and this is that calligraphy, which Lucknow architecture is famous for. They are all written in Arabic, and they are ayats of Quran. And this, look at the detailing in stucco work. We don't have any stone, we don't have any rocks. It is all made in bricks and mortar. So and the Rajputana jharokas, all style, of course. And this machli motif, the fish motif, is another big typical feature of Lucknow, which you can find in most of the buildings. A pair of fish at the entrance. That's the Nawabs used to believe that it was auspicious for them. So now, how did they articulate their arches and columns? With the help of this stucco work, they took out the extra work, extra material from the pillar and carved out various pattern, floral patterns, and geometric patterns. So they look more slender and more beautiful and elegant. That's how they carved out their pillars. And in fact, when the building was massive, they used to put black background, and on the, with the help of white color, they used to paint with the sort of jali work, so that the massiveness is decreased and it becomes more delicate and elegant. You can see this in Husainabad Imamgarha. This is the Husainabad Imamgarha, the top one. Here, a lot of calligraphy can be seen with, of course, the gilded dome. This is the entrance of the Bada Imamgarha, and this is that entrance of the Bulbulaiya Bada Imamgarha. And of course, this is the famous signature building of Lucknow, the Rumi Darwaza, the gateway of Constantinople. It is a Turkish gateway, a replica of Turkish gateway, which was also made in the time of Asafuddallah. Now, coming to this particular region, particular area, Husainabad. It has the maximum number of buildings, and we have lot many imambaras and mosques. You can see again, beauty. This is the Sarkhanda. This is the Jama Masjid. It has Rajputana elements as well. The mihrab effect has been given with the use of multiple arches, and then in fact, with the help of curved surface, lot of stucco work has been put inside, and it's all as good as some like rock architecture or that carvings in the rock. You cannot make out that it's not rock. The delicacy and the beauty of the sophistication of the carving. So that's the feature. Now coming to the Bada Imambara in detail, it is supposed to be the largest unsupported hall in the world, in fact. And it was a big engineering feat at that time. It was built in the 1782 it started, in fact, and completed in 1785. And it was a it has a wonderful ventilation system, and of course it was a work of piety as well. At that time there was a famine in Awadh, and the Nawab Asifuddaula used to build it day and night. The day he used to build it, and in the night he used to deconstruct it. He used to demolish it, so that all kind of people used to get employment. The rich used to work in the night, and the poor in the daytime. So the theology and the kind of piousness was also present in these Nawabs, the previous ones. Of course, at the later period, there was a lot of bad things which Britishers also highlighted, and they confiscated the kingdom and everything. They were taken away. But the previous Nawabs, they had a very high character, and they used to, of course, their love for architecture is world famous. Now it weighs this the dimensions of the hall is almost like 50 feet by 150 feet, and the thickness of the slab was 16 feet. And but still it was lighter because the material was taken out from the thickness of the slab. And for that reason, it was that Bulbulia was created. Almost 489 openings are there, from first floor to third floor, which is reached by from the southern side through a staircase, and that's how Bulbulaiya was created. But why? It was for air and ventilation, and also to make it lighter. The material was scooped out from the slab so that it became light to hold the walls and the such a big slab of say the length was almost like 162 feet. So that long span, you need a thick slab, but still the slab was, of course, 16 feet, but it was hollow from inside. That was the technology. And that main hall, it was divided into three parts. It has one China hall, known as China hall, then the other is the Indian hall, and the central hall is that particular rectangular hall. Yes.
Hello? Vipul madam, we can take a small break right now, because immediately the meeting will stop. So we will join with a new link. I request everybody to join at 5:20 with a new link which we have posted on the chat box.
Okay
madam. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you. I finish
it at Bada Imambara. Thank you.
Yes. We will resume, madam. Soon we will resume. Yeah. Madam, thank you so much. Yeah.
You can see it?
Yes, madam. It's clear, madam. Madam, you can make it full screen.
Yeah, I'm doing it. Yeah. Okay. This one. Yeah, we were talking about Bada Imambara complex. Now, the central hall, the main hall, it had, of course, 16 feet high, deep slab. And the other two halls, one was the China hall, the other was called Indian hall. And China hall, it had ribs in its dome, and like a watermelon. There is a story, small story behind it. You know, history can be very boring if you don't have anecdotes and tales in it. So it's a small story that there was one old lady who used to sell watermelons in the land of where Imambara was to be built. Now the Nawab, he asked for that land, and she said, I'll only give the land if you tell, if you put a tazia on Muharram from my side inside the Imambara. And Nawab, of course, said yes. And to honor her, one of the halls are named after her. The Kharbuze Wala Kamra, that's the hall was known, is known as the Indian Hall. And it has Rajputana style balconies, the jharukas inside jutting out, and the ribbing as like watermelon. And the other one, it's a square in plan, the other hall is square in plan, with the which becomes octagon above, and of course 16 faces at the top, which has a flat roof above. Now, we have already talked about its light and ventilation and its lightness, and its the length is the, in fact, the biggest in the world at that time. And in fact, in among the historical buildings, still the record is, I think you can see it, no? It's closed. hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Achha, of course, I was a little confused if you people are there or not. The video was off or something. Okay, I'll continue. Now, another structure which is there in the complex is the Bauli, which has a Rajputana style of architecture. And the feature, main feature about it is when the person visits it, at the entrance itself, the reflection of that visitor comes into the Bauli, and that person can be seen from inside. And all around it has rooms in the Rajputana style. So it was a very grand engineering feat of that time, this Bada Imambara complex. These are some of the pictures. This is the central hall with the stucco work, the biggest one. This is the central hall, the largest hall. And these are some pictures. And this is that Kharbuze Wala Kamra. And this is the ceiling with stucco work. This is the entrance veranda. And these are some more pictures. Look at the ceiling, the work. Beautiful it is. Now coming to the other one, it is also called Chota Imambara, but it's a Husainabad Imambara made by Muhammad Ali Shah. this has a beautiful gilded dome and calligraphy in black and white at its entrance. And of course, the style is Indo-Islamic. And it is also called the Palace of Lights. In fact, a Russian traveler, a prince, von Ulrich, had come, and he had named it as the Palace of Lights because of beautiful glass work which is there in the central hall, the chandeliers, and they were all brought from Belgium and Europe. So the Nawabs were very rich, and they had no dearth of wealth. So that they wanted to build Lucknow as the center of Shias, the Shiite center in the whole world. That's how all the Nawab kept on building these grand buildings. And this building had hammams also, which used to have hot water supply and the cold water supply at that time. And of course, there's a mosque and there's a bazaar. It's a full-fledged mosque. In fact, these imambaras, they were a full-fledged sort of an experience in itself. These Nawabs used to build. So it had now this was Sawal and Jawab. This was, one is the hammam and the other is a tomb. And this is that main building. So, and there's a central axial symmetry with the stream running in the center with lotus pond and fishes, and all kind of artifacts were there. Coming to Jama Masjid, it was again built by Muhammad Ali Shah, and it has a beautiful work which I had already explained. The use of multi-centered arches giving a mihrab effect, and then filling it with stucco work, giving it almost like a Rajputana style of architecture, but it is all done in stucco work. So it has a, of course, a hall, and it has 260 pillars which it's supporting, and of course the domes are there in almost 15 in numbers, small and big. Some are seen, some are not. And two minarets in of 4 stories high. So look at now the parapet. You can see it has that those arches, and instead of domes, they have lantern kind of detail. So that's the difference. But parapet is always very elaborate in this of the architecture. Coming to Husainabad Clock Tower, it is a later development. In fact, at the time when Sir George Cooper came, it was built. And in fact, it was supposed to be the biggest at that time, taller than Westminster in the UK. It was that big. And there are 12 petaled flower shaped dial in the center. And the pendulum is almost 14 feet long. It was another engineering feat of that time. And in fact, afterwards, I'll be explaining, Sir Baskin Payne was the architect, and he was the first architect to be brought from UK to India. And this was his first construction in India. And after this clock tower, he was sent to Calcutta to build lot many colonial buildings over there. So this was the first building made by any British architect on at that time, that British Raj in Lucknow. In fact, in India, but it was done in Lucknow. Now, Satkhanda, coming to Satkhanda, it was planned as a Nokhanda by Muhammad Ali Shah. It has a Greco-Roman influence. Of course, at that time, Claude Martin had made his Constantia, his Lamartine, and lot many buildings with European elements. So the Nawabs were trying to copy certain elements. Here, the amalgamation is being seen, and it was supposedly 9 stories, but some mishappening happened, and the Nawab fell during the supervision, and it was stopped. It was made as Satkhanda only. So it was another building by Muhammad Ali Shah. Now, courtesans of Lucknow, the Nawabi period will not be complete until we talk of these ladies. In fact, they had a very big influence on the public in general and Nawabs. They were the preservers of art and culture of that time, and they were proficient in classical singing and Kathak style of dancing, and they were in fact very well versed in the art of conversation, which is called Nazakat and Nafasat of Lucknow. And for their kothis in the old chowk of Lucknow are still there. And in fact, the noblemen used to send their sons to learn the etiquette and mannerism from them. That was that limit of their literacy, you can say. And they were very well versed in poetry and literature and art and everything. The art of calligraphy, of course, I've explained. And in fact, chicken curry, if we don't talk of it, then of course, it will not be justified, the whole presentation. Now, there's a story behind it that there's Sher Khan. He was traveling from Calcutta. In fact, it said that Noor Jahan was patronizing this art in Delhi. So this Sher Khan had come to Lucknow, and he met a poor peasant. And in return of his hospitality, he tailored this art to this first peasant. And this how this art came to Lucknow. And it said in the time of Wajid Ali Shah, he had 365 concubines in his harem. And each day, that lady used to make one topi for Wajid Ali Shah to vie for his attention, because the most beautiful topi the lady made, the Nawab used to give his attention to her. So that's how the vocabulary of chicken curry developed. And in fact, there's a gastronomy which is very important in Lucknow and very world famous, of course, the kebabs and all. But there's a difference between Mughlai food and Nawabi food. It's more sophisticated Nawabi food. There are multiple straining. The aroma is beautiful and the texture is very smooth. It is that's the difference between Nawabi and the Mughlai food. So of course it came from Mughlai, but there were improvements which happened in Lucknow. And of course there's a small story of Murad Ali, who, the famous person who developed these tumde kebab, which are world famous in Dubai and Europe also. He Asif Uddaula was a couch potato. He wanted something in soft plate. So there were a lot of innovations were being done in the kitchens in their palaces. So this person, he fell off from his terrace and he broke his arm. But he kept on working on his kebabs. And one day the Nawab said, "Who prepared this?" He said, "Somebody said Tunde had prepared it, a one arm person." So from that day, those kebabs they came to be known as Tunde ke kebab and became very famous. And it said that around 200 spices, 160 are confirmed, are being put in these kebabs to make it so delicious. It comes out to be a world famous delicacy of Lucknow. Now coming to residency, it's now a compound. It's a complex of lot many European buildings at a high ground which faced Gomti River at one side and the city on the other side. And it was in fact built by Saadat Ali Khan, the son or the half brother of Asif Uddaula, who brought in fact British, and he was made Nawab with the help of British only. So he wanted to please them, but if you see them, like, it had it was a full-fledged compound, the church, the post office, the hospital, and not many buildings were there, but all were in European style villa with flat roof and pillars, portico coming out, one central hall with the rooms around, and the veranda for the summer's tropical climate. So these were the villas. These were the some of the buildings which are in ruins these days. And of course, there's a grave of Henry Lawrence, the famous Governor General of Britishers, was involved in the First War of Independence, and it's here he was killed, and there's a grave of his is here. In fact, it said that the famous siege of Residency, when they were all driven to Residency, the Britishers, by the rebels, the Indian rebels, they were barricaded and they were not allowed to come out, and the Indians were shelling and attacking them from outside. Now, one shell came inside his room and fell when he was having his breakfast. He said, "Now the people said, you change your room. The people are making you target, these Indians." He said, "No, why would another bullet come to me? One is already here. So I will not change." And next day itself, the 4th of June, 1846, it was the date, then the bullet hit him again and he died on the spot. So his grave is here. Not many Britishers died in that siege of Residency. And it's a very popular monument of Lucknow where Europeans and Britishers come and have look, and they find the ancestry and the buildings. A lot of many researches are going on. In fact, there was one Vilayati Begum. Her bungalow, her koti is also there. She was a wife of Ghaziuddin Haider. She was, in fact, European. So her palace and one mosque, Imambara, is also there. So apart from these European buildings, some Indo-Sassanic buildings are also there. Coming to Charbagh, this is another signature buildings of Lucknow. It's a beautiful railway station at the moment. It was made on Munawar Bagh, that old Nawabi garden of Lucknow. And the architect was J.H. Horniman, and it has if you see from above, it looks like a chessboard, because the domes, there are cluster of domes together, and with the towering arcaded towers and elongated avdi domes, And the beautiful part is that if you are outside, you cannot see any noise of inside when you are outside. No, the trains going and coming, no whistling, no sound can be heard. The acoustics is so perfect. In fact, this was, of course, that cost was 70 lakhs at that time, and it's still being maintained beautifully, and we are using it. So if you see these looks like chess pieces on a chessboard, if you see from above. Now coming to the famed and magnificent Kesar Bagh of Wajid Ali Shah, which was razed to ground. Of course, we can't see anymore, but these are some of the gates and the fish emblem, which is very famous in Lucknow. And these are the semicircular arches of colonial architecture, as well as multifoliated arches with this stucco work trimmed with Avdhi Guldasta. This is called the Avdhi Guldasta, and the brackets and everything. And of course, this element is taken from the European Claude Martin building, the Lamartine, which will be coming further. So this is a signature element of European building of our the Lamartine Constantia, which is being also used. So it was a neo classical style, and postmodern influence can be seen in this. These are some of the shots. Like in fact, this is a inside of the Kesar Bagh, and it's like a Asian concept of a walled enclosure with multiple courtyards, one courtyards opening to another, and the buildings are all around. It had Baradari in the center, and of Charbagh pattern gardens, pavilions, gazebos, statues, fountains, cascades, whatnot. Like it was here that Bertrand Russell said, not Rome, not Constantinople can tempt if I'm in Lucknow. So that's what it's being said. Now in the west, there was a Badsha Manzil, Dare Daulat, Rahat Manzil, then beautiful Sher Darwaza. So it had gilded domes, the inverted lotus pinnacle, and of course the chhatars are there. These are called the Hindu umbrella. Chhatars were also present after the building. The Chhatar Manzil was built by Sadat Ali Khan. These came into being in quite a few buildings of Awadh. This is a Hindu element which was brought in, and multi-ribbed domes, all gilded, and lanterns and Moorish minarets. It was a page out of Arabian Nights, this palace. And here it said that he used to play as Kanhaiya and Ras Leela, and he used to write dance dramas, Wajid Ali Shah. And of course, he was very fond of poetry and Kathak and classical singing. A lot of development had taken place in his time. So here, in fact, in the First War of Independence, this Major Neil was killed, and this Sher Darwaza is still there, which had one portrait of his, the bust of his, which is now removed. So here, a lot of things happened in the First War of Independence, and it had the impact of postmodern architecture also, because it had lot many colors, and the stucco work was highlighted with pastel shades. So the European architecture had lot of influence in this particular building. And of course, it was razed to ground after the First War of Independence, as explained before. Now, coming to the most beautiful building in the center of the heart, it's the tomb of Sadat Ali Khan. Now, beautiful proportions it has. And had it been in marble or stone, it would have been like an excellence in architecture. But of course, it is in lime mortar and Lakhori bricks, but still the proportions are very good. The parapets, typical parapets, and the inverted Guldasta finial, and the parapets are accented with chhatris, And the Sadat Ali Khan tomb is in two floors, but Khushizadi, her daughter, it's a four levels. The actual grave is in the basement and the cenotaph is on the ground floor. And on the top floor, it's terrace with the edging of chhatris and a dome in the center, which is octagon and elongated, and a fluted narrow ribs on the tomb. So that's these are the two tombs which are there in the heart of the city. Coming to Roshanuddin Koti, it was part of the Kesar Bagh, which was sort of ignored by British. They couldn't erase it. And it was Kesar Pasand. In fact, Kesar Bagh was also known as Kesar Bagh because it was in golden ochre in color. So Kesar, saffron colored. And the king was also, his name was Mirza Kesar Jamun. So, ho sakta hai, due to this or the color, it was known as Kesar Bagh. But this Roshanuddin Koti was of his minister, Nawaz minister, and he had amassed so much of wealth that his building was greater than the Badsha itself. So the corruption was at that time also. And the very famous Chhappan Churi, that dacoits of those time, the it was the case was heard in this particular building itself by the Britishers itself. Then this another one built, this another building. It's called Parikhana, where it was a kind of a harem or a center of art and culture, as Wajid Ali used to say. There were around 500 ladies who were sort of living here, and they were just for the promotion of art and culture and poetry. It's called Parikhana. Now it's Bhatkhande Music of Dance and Music. The government has made it into an institute of music and dance. And of course, we can talk of Zardozi. Zardozi is also one of the art of Lucknow, which was patronized by the Awadh. Coming to Hazratganj, it was built by Sadat Ali Khan, again, in the period which was the golden period of Awadh. And in fact, it was a processional pathway, and which had two gateways in the east and the west. Half Lycian, half Moorish, at one two ends, and in the middle of the both side of the road, there were bungalows and the kotis of the prince of the Badsha of the Nawab. And but after the Britishers came, it was totally changed in colonial building, and a shopping arcade was built, and in colonial style, the Corinthian columns, the Ionic columns. They came into being, but the typical parapet, it modified, but it was not totally gone. You can see that, and it was also called as Queensway by Britishers, because the procession used to go with a lot of music and band in the center of the street, and at one end was the Koti Hayat Baksh, and the other end was the Koti Noor Baksh. At Koti Hayat Baksh, the Viceroy used to stay. So, of course, there were cathedrals, and the Sahu Theatre is the first multiplex of India. In fact, it was built here. It had two theatres, one over the other. On the ground floor, it was Prince of Wales Hall, and on the first floor, it was called Plaza. In fact, it is still working, and now it is known as Sahu Theatre. So it is almost 200-year-old multiplex, still working. Light is so. Now another Imambara is there in Hazrat Ganj, which was made by Amjad Ali Khan, Amjad Ali Shah. Again, there's a tomb inside of the Nawab, and a typical multi-arched raised on a high plinth, and typical of the parapet. It has a central hall with flanked by multiple rooms and hammams, bathing spaces, etc., etc. this is a place where it said that Jahangir had come and stayed for a while, and it's another landmark building of Lucknow, and it's a big koti with multiple arches, multi-centric arches, stucco work, and those parapet and chhatris. The Victoria Memorial was built to commemorate the reign of Queen Victoria at that particular time, the colonial period, and it still exists. And it's a beautiful marble structure brought from Makrana. Another Imambara, Shah Najaf Imambara, it was made by Ghaziuddin Haider. And in fact, this was a replica of Hazrat Ali, the tomb of Hazrat Ali, the husband of Fatima. And then it shows two masonry lines. That's it. It's very, very clear. That's the Shias believe. It has some significance in their religious scriptures. Again, the pinnacle is gilded and inverted lotus bases. And this has a flatter dome and not fluted. So this is another one in the heart of the city. There's some other buildings of main. This is a Baradari where Wajid Ali Shah was crowned, and it is in red Mirzapur stone. The brackets and chhatris are there, but the parapet is missing. And it had lot of historical incidents attached to it, which happened. Very important incidents in history of Lucknow. And coming to Chhatar Manzil. Chhatar Manzil is again a typical known like by Chhatar or umbrella, a part of very important part of Hindu architecture taken from Rajputana, and it had, this dome had a chhajja also. It was made by Saadat Ali Khan in the memory of his Hindu mother, Chhatar Kuvar. And she died, and in fact Saadat Ali Khan was also not made Nawab directly. He was brought by British. He was not made Nawab by his father, and he respected his mother a lot, and in his memory he made this building. It is two stories, and it has a flatter facade, and the facade is in fact sort of enhanced by Tuscan, half Tuscan pillars and multi-foliated arches. And the first floor has oval balconies overlooking it. So this is another view. And next, adjacent to it is a Farhad Baksh Koti. This is one koti which was made by Lord Martin. This is a French builder. And it is again double story, and it has a French influence. And it has a Gothic feel because of these pediments and Tuscan orders. And on the top, it has a viewing gallery with cluster of Ionic columns. And in fact, Saadat Ali Khan made some rooms on the first floor itself. And it said it has two. It had two basements. The architecturally, it was very well designed in a sense that the other side is facing River Gomti. And in the rainy season, the basement was full of water. The rainwater the river water used to enter the building, and the resident used to ascend on top of other upper floors. As the river used to ascend, the resident, the person living there, the Claude Martin, also came to ground floor, then first floor and second floor. And in the summer months, the basement was so cool that he used to reside in the basement, and it was the coolest building in the whole Avadh. And in the winters, he was on the top floor to get a lot of sunshine, and it was not that cold upstairs. So it was very well designed building on the banks of River Gomti. And it had a lot of influence afterwards in the later buildings of Avadh. This is the main building, Lamartinier, which was made by Claude Martin, the French builder. He was in fact a surveyor, and he fought for British in South also. In fact, one of his cannons, in fact, cannons are put here. One of the cannon is brought to Tipu Sultan from Srirangpatna. And other was called Cornwallis. So he fought many battles in his lifetime, but he almost became a royalty because of he amassed so much of wealth, and he was so interactive with the royalties that he considered himself a royal. And of course, he built this as a palace or a fort, you can say, but it was made in a style of a Mughal tomb because of his high plinth. You can see it's raised to a very high plinth, and but the European influence can be seen with these Corinthian pillars, statues. But the Hindu influence can be seen with the chhatris and of course the parapets. And like it is, some people say it's a confused building, but whatever it is, they call it a wedding cake also, a Gothic wedding cake also, some historians have called it. But whatever it is, but it is one of the magnificent building in the whole of Lucknow. And this is how it looks. Now it's a boys' college, Lamartya College, a very prestigious college of the city. So it is almost like 200 acres of land, and it is an axial symmetry. One face of the building faces the river Gomti, and the other has a gardens and landscape lawns at the back. So now, on the first floor, it has 12 lions, in fact, which had flaming torches in their mouths. So it was built to a fort like to scare the enemy also. But afterwards, I think it's been said that he changed his mind and he made it as a tomb of his. And he's buried here as well afterwards. So, but the stucco work inside is beautiful. The ceilings are beautiful. It's said that he brought all the plaster of Paris for his statues from Paris itself at that time. And he made it very lovingly. That's it. The architecturally, it is very well designed in a sense. It has a natural ventilation system. The towers at the edges, the periphery, the 8 towers, if you see the plan, the towers at the periphery, they have the ventilation tubes, the terracotta ducts going inside till the basement. They bring in the cool air from the river Gomti and circulated on the upper floors. And all the rooms are being aerated and full of air. That's how it's naturally air conditioned building of that time. And of course, these 4 octagons, they actually form the foundation of this building, and these have some different functions as explained. So it's a very well designed building, and of course inside the stucco work is beautiful. You can see the chapel, and again it's all done in lined mortar plaster. And these are some of the statue works that those have been put on the first floor terrace. And this block, the central tower, in fact, it is for the aesthetic reason only. It doesn't have much of a function. Only 2 floors were habitable. This was done for the aesthetic elevation reason only. Now, this particular element is very different, which is was copied afterwards in our buildings, the intersecting arches, not a dome, but intersecting arches, which were copied in Kesar Bagh also afterwards. This was a signature style of his. Now, the next building is Dilkusha. Again, this is a summer house of Saadat Ali Khan. He made it for Major Gore Ozley. He was a friend of Nawab Saadat Ali Khan, and it resembles Seat and Delaval Hall, a building in Northumberland, England. And it's a replica of that building. And you can see the English style, in fact, mimicry of stone on the facade, the semicircular arches, and a jutting portico, which is a typical of a European bungalow. And that's it. In fact, stone has been mimicked on the facade. That recalls their British buildings of England. Now, coming to colonial Lucknow, if we see the architecture after 1856, now the British had come to control Awadh and Lucknow, and it was not many churches were designed, and the architect was Major Cromwellan, and they are all in neo-Gothic style. And this is the clock tower which was built by Richard Roskell Bain, and it is almost like 220 feet high, and almost 30 square feet of area is taken, but it has a battered base, and on top is a Turkish dome. And again, the clock has been explained before, but it is an all exposed brickwork and beautiful proportions. And this was the first building by a British architect in India. And afterwards, in the Edwardian era, the university came up, the medical college came up. It was designed by Leishman, Major Leishman. He was the architect. And not many colonial buildings can be seen in Lucknow with beautiful proportion. Again, the Indo-Sassanic architecture, the tombs are there, the gilded domes, the fluting is there, the inverted lotus and the pinnacles are very much there. And of course, the chhatris, they could not do away with chhatris. The parapet is there. So, but the proportions are little different from the original one. But all the elements are being amalgamated, the Hindu, the Islamic, and the colonial. That's the typical architecture which was found in the later period. Now, in fact, the other architect was Samuel Jacob. He also built. In fact, these are the architects who had built all over India. And Lucknow has some signature buildings by these British architects. This is our council house. In fact, the present Vidhan Sabha also. It was also built at the same time. And in fact, it was built by Henry Lancaster and Thomas Lodge. And again, the Rajputana style elements were also amalgamated, and beautiful stucco work. In fact, it is cladded by stone, by Dholpur stone, again brought from Rajasthan. But the proportions, and you can see the semicircular arches have come up, the typical European arches, but the detailing, if you see the brackets and the stucco work has been copied in stone as well. Here, the architect has tried to bring in the Awadh architecture in his colonial building as well. And this Vipul is another telegraph building.
Vipul madam. Vipul, yes, madam, we have another just 10 minutes to wind up the session.
Okay. I'm trying to wind up. Yeah.
Yes, madam.
Now this is the modern era, of course. Now this is the famous Ambedkar Parks of Lucknow, and one very important thing: Walter Burley Griffin of Australia had come here and made quite a few buildings. The Tagore Library is here. In more postmodern style. Then, of course, after independence, the commemoration of a memory was exploited by Indian leaders, and lot many monuments and parks were created, memorials are created with Buddhist imagery, the stupa, the domes, the stupa openings, the railings, they were all brought from Buddhist architecture, and gigantic elephants and political insignia were brought in. In fact, Satish Gujral's Ambedkar Memorial is very much in the heart of the city, with the signifying the eight principles of Buddhism. These are some of the buildings in later period. You can see the grandness. Of course, the details are gigantic in proportion. But of course, it was criticized due to the lack of greenery, and a lot of stone has been brought up. But of course, the urban spaces are dwarfing the built spaces. That's the only demerit which architects can see in it. But aesthetically, there are two very pleasing. These are some of the memorials, some of the eco parks. So, like, if I wind up, like, if I can say something, like, like in Urdu poetry, it is not a matter of new topics which are brought by the poet, but it is the interpretation of old topics which are done in the poetry. In the same way, here, like even the colonial architecture or Islamic architecture is interpreted in a different manner. That's what is the uniqueness is created in Lucknow. And it is one of the five most livable cities as per the London Telegraph. So in art and culture, as per the living style, the living pattern, it is one of the most livable cities in India. And that's it. That's how I can end my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, madam. We really enjoyed your presentation. And right now, your words are echoing in my mind. Not Rome, not Constantinople can tempt us if we are in Lucknow. And the picture imagery was really a page out of the Arabian stories. We were really, really impressed, madam. I think everybody has enjoyed the presentation. Just to recap your presentation a little bit for everyone. A detailed chronological explanation of the seat of power of Lucknow and its influence on life, art and architecture was really very interestingly explained by you. The beautiful stucco work, the calligraphic inscriptions of Quran, the pair of fish motif of the amalgamation of Islamic and Rajput and the amalgamation of Islamic and Rajputana architecture was so well expressed by you, madam. The gorgeous massive parapet of the Imambara as explained by you, and the awesome structure which was the largest structure without support was all the amazing architect engineering feats were very, very impressive, madam. We really enjoyed it a lot. The watermelon story, the Kharbuja Wala Mahal, the Palace of Lights, all has left us just awestruck. It was very amazing to know that there were structures which were in comparison to the marvelous and gorgeous architecture of Westminster Abbey. The ladies of the Lucknow culture, which were famous for the Nazakat and the Nafasat, and the chikankari, the Nawabi food, all has just left us awestruck, madam. We are really very, very thankful to you. It was an amazing presentation, and I am doubtful that we have time right now for question answers, but I would just go through the chats. There are many appreciations. People are really very impressed, but I will just see through the chats if I have some questions for you, madam.
Sure.
We have got many comments that it has been highly impressive. They have all enjoyed the session, madam. Highly informative also.
Thank you.
I think we can